I know you often say you don't recommend Malinois pet very often. Was I wondering if you would train a Mal differently than a GSD? If so, how? Yeah. Yeah, you know, it's not about training a Mal. Okay, bottom line is this. Here's an interesting philosophy for everybody to think about. Just think about it. It's not a judgment. I'm not passing judgment on anybody. I'm not passing judgment. Everyone like this, I'm passing judgment on them. It's like, listen to my body of work, okay? Just listen to my body of work. I got 10,000 hours of audio out there. Listen to my body of work. You won't find me passing judgment, except for on PETA, bunch of fucking assholes. So other than that, I believe, listen, first of all, if you've got a Malinois you need help with, I will help you. But let's think about this concept. I believe that if you get a Malinois, you should not need a trainer for basic obedience. Think about it. If you're going to get a Malinois, which are incredibly high drive dogs that are not meant for family living and are mostly meant for sport and work, I believe that if you're going to get a Malinois, you should have the skill set to train basic obedience with the dog. And you should probably understand simple behavior modification. It's a challenging dog, not for me, but for, you know, for your average person. So what would I do differently? I would make sure that the dog was safe. So I wouldn't let, I mean, like most dogs, I don't let any dog slip up when it comes to aggression. I would want to make sure that dog was underneath incredible voice control. And I would want to make sure that dog understood tools really, really well, because the owner's going to have to probably rely on the tools at the beginning or maybe even at the end, because of you're going to need tools to override some of its innate, you know, genetic qualities of its drive. So.
Great.
Oh, going live. Oh, we're live. Oh, there we go. Hey, everybody. How are you? What's going on? How's everybody doing? What day of the week is today?
I don't know.
Wednesday. We leave for Reno tomorrow. Tomorrow. Yeah, sure. Did you do food prep?
Yeah.
Did you?
Haven't done laundry.
I got duck heads today. I got picked up duck
that
heads.
That place is good, right?
Oh my gosh. I got duck heads. Duck necks.
Secret. I can't let anybody know about
duck wings.
Yep.
And I got shumai out the wazoo.
What?
Shumai.
What's that?
You know what shumai is? Like little dumplings? You've had them before when we go to Thai food?
No.
Japanese restaurant? Oh, wait till you see all the stuff. Wait till you see in the RV what we're going to be making. Okay. Oh, I bought a little steamer, little bamboo steamer.
Can you eat that stuff?
Oh, yeah, you will.
Dieting right now.
This is all diet stuff. Hey, everybody. How are you? It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. This is Joelle. Joelle is one of our trainers at the training center. You also see her on the seminar circuit with me. She also does the social media. We leave tomorrow for Reno, Nevada. Tickets are still selling. Sold like four of them today. Nice. Yeah. So still selling. Go to jeffgellmanseminars.com, jeffgellmanseminars.com. And what you can do there is you can see all the seminars. The next two that are coming up are going to be Reno, Canton, Ohio, and Collingwood, Ontario, Canada. Stunning there. I hope we get there a day early. We can check out the beaches. Really nice. That's exciting. Oh, we're a dog training center rehab facility up in Providence, Rhode Island. We specialize in very, very challenging dogs. Give us your aggressive dogs. Give us your leash reactive dogs. Give us your separation anxiety dogs. Give us dogs that bite humans, bites kids. We'll take them. We're really good at rehabbing dogs. But we also do basic stuff. Like yesterday, today there was a video of Joelle doing some clicker work, clicker food work. We do all clicker work and food work with all the dogs. That's how we train dogs to do stuff. But the gist of this seminar is stopping unwanted behaviors. The gist of this show is stopping unwanted behaviors. So most people ask us, how do I stop? How do I stop? How do I stop? A lot of our social media content is also geared towards that. Why? It's actually not that hard to train sit, down, place, recall, heel. Heel with a leash reactive dog can be challenging. But stopping unwanted behaviors, number one, that's why you give up your dog. That's why you kill your dog. And that's why people struggle for years. So that's the gist of the show. That's the mission that we're on to solve people's problems, to make them happy. So you're going to hear me say the word punishment a lot. the reason why I say punishment a lot, because nobody else wants to use the damn word, but that's actually what it is. But remember, with punishment, you're not mad, you're not angry. I don't want to yell at my dog and hit my dog. Okay, well, neither do I. So a punishment is actually calm, cool, and collected. As a matter of fact, I don't like that. That wasn't good. Now you have to learn how to master the art of delivering a punisher in a calm, cool, collected way. That's why we love tools, because we like to leverage those things. Properly applied punishment does not destroy the relationship with your dog at all. Even from 8 weeks old, it does not do it at all. You've been lied to. You are being lied to by unethical people that can't solve problems. They just spout a bunch of hot air. They actually don't do the work. So ask a question, we'll give you an answer. Most questions need really long answers. That's why I also do Skype sessions. I'm up to like 3 or 4 a day now. A lot of Skypes around the world. Australia, Australia, Germany, Canada, and then a lot in the US already this week. So also there's something called Top Chat down at the bottom. A lot of people can't get their questions answered because I talk a lot. We get through over 100 questions though. You put your question down at the bottom where it says say something. Someone does a Top Chat, goes right to the top. It's something that YouTube does, but you don't have to pay to play. We answer so many questions on three of these a week I do, plus my AMAs I do. $9.99 from Rena. Hi, Jeff. I have a 4-month-old Australian Shepherd, and she knows how to do basic commands, but she won't do it without treats. It's a struggle. I appreciate you. So, Rena, I appreciate you. Rena? Rena? The dog's 16 weeks old. You're supposed to be using treats. But stop using treats, actually. Use the dog's daily food. The dog's going to shit all over the place. Use the dog's daily kibble. Let it work for its food. We do the exact same thing. Have you done 4,000 repetitions yet? No. All right? So it's 16 weeks old on something that the dog should know what wrong is. You can probably start incorporating no very shortly and then start doing a punisher for noncompliance only on obedience commands that you've done probably a minimum of 500 times. And then you're going to start working on duration, and you're going to work on distance, and you're going to work on distraction. But if your dog knows sit, and it knows sit very well, first of all, if you're luring, you shouldn't be luring, you should be rewarding. So a reward-based training program, the food comes after the marker. So your hands are empty. Sit, dog sits. You mark it with yes or clicker. Then you deliver the food. So your hand is out of the food bag. You don't have food in your hand unless you're doing luring, which you shouldn't. You should get off of pretty quick. So with a reward-based training program, your hands are empty. So the dog should do it. If it's not doing it, then you need to start applying a light punisher. All right. And then we've got another Top Chat. Don't worry, we get to all the questions. Josue, I've run out of questions for now, LOL, but thank you. Awesome. Thank you so much. All right. Here we go, Joelle. Jump right in.
Double DD pet lover. Hey, thanks for all you do, empowering owners and saving dogs. I have a 10-month pup working on place and using pet corrector for jumping. For the most part, he is good. How do I handle random occasional jumps?
Dogs shouldn't be jumping. Dogs just shouldn't be jumping. So you haven't stopped it. You haven't made jumping suck enough. So for all the folks out there that are brand new to the show, if you ever hear a good question to ask a trainer, if you're shopping for trainers, is this. How do I stop jumping now? That's a great question to ask any dog trainer. Any dog trainer should be able to tell you step by step how they fix it, and it should take less than 5 seconds. If they say things such as, teach a sit, don't hire them. Turn your back, don't hire them. Ignore the dog, don't hire them. Distract them, don't hire them. None of those things work. You have to make jump. You have to apply a proper punisher for the act of jumping. You have to make jumping suck. That's how you do it. So I would go to forget the pet corrector. I would go to a remote collar or a leash prong combo. And I've got a video on how to do that. Next.
Jose, hey, Jeff, I have a 1-year-old GSD female, and I'm trying to get her to stop running down the stairs every time I get home.
Yeah.
Also, how do I get her to stop whining every time I take my other puppy out of the cage? She's very friendly and also goes up to people when there's guests to be petted.
So I wouldn't allow that dog to do that. 12 months old?
1-year-old.
1-year-old German Shepherd? Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's stop that. Not because it's German. Yeah, well, you know, this is the thing. I'm not a big fan. My dogs are social. My dogs are friendly. They can be pet. I don't want my dog walking up to people. I just don't. most people don't know how to pet a dog. I don't want my dog to be so distracted by humans. I want them to be focused on me. So a bunch of questions here. Whining, remote collar, or bonker, you can correct that. And role play it. Take your puppy out of the crate. Tell the dog no, correct. Role play it. Remote collar also works great. Okay, next.
Blessing. Hello, I've worked with nonsense and snotty aggressive behavior before. However, my dog is defense fear aggressive towards humans, kids, and dogs. He chooses fight over flight 100% of the time.
Mm-hmm.
He'll just run up to someone 20 feet away and try to attack
him. Okay, that's not fear. Just to let you know, that's not fear. Yep.
I've been working with him with the technique of correcting him with the e-collar just before he reacts. My question is, what would be my next more after making it clear to him that being a jerk isn't an option?
Okay.
Do I do that counter condition with treats thing?
Okay, this is what I want you to do. It's one thing at a time. I want you to know your dog's most likely not fearful. All right? That's not flight. Running up to somebody 20 feet away and barking or aggressing towards them. Is that what that was? Mm-hmm. That's not flight. So, nope, there's a lot of other options your dog could have done. Number one, if your dog is doing that, please keep it on a leash. Your dog shouldn't be off leash. So the responsible thing is to keep your dog on a leash. What I want you to start doing is you should be applying an extremely firm punisher for your dog wanting to run up to somebody like that. So don't apply the punisher when it gets to the person. I wouldn't even do it on the way to the person. I would do it at the first sign that your dog wants to do it. So what you're doing is you're punishing the thought of doing it. The thought of doing it. Now we're going to put your dog into some fear. Yes, you can use fear. For all the people out there, you guys use fear to train. Damn fucking right we do. Hello? You want to bite my child? I'll put the fear of God in you. Hello, people. Sit down, place, recall, heal. No. Biting? You better use fear. That's going to save that dog's life and save a child from being harmed. Nobody wants to talk about this stuff. Absolutely. Oh, it'll make it worse. Since when? Prove it. Show me the study. Show me the fucking dog. I'm not angry either, guys. This is all the stuff I hear. And it's what it is I respond in this fashion because you can hear two voices, right? My name's not Sybil. I'm 14 voices short. So this is the thing. I'm saying this because I know what other people are responding, what other people say. The bottom line is owners are struggling. They're being lied to. No, how do you fix aggression? With overwhelming force. That's how you fix it. That's how you stop it. Overwhelming force. Absolutely. And then, now let's build the dog back up. Oh, so you break him down and build him up? When it comes to aggression, absolutely. Next. Oh, 10, 10, was that Australia?
I think so.
Andrew James, is it best to use a distraction-free environment when introducing an e-collar and working up the correct levels? Andrew, bingo, question of the day. Yes, absolutely. Low environmentals, because then if not, your levels will be too all over the place. Ideally, you do it inside in a very quiet area. Absolutely. Next.
Grace, if a dog walks very nice with one handler and then is walked by a different one, will the dog behave the same?
Absolutely not.
Does it depend on the leash handling skills of each person? Thanks.
It's a couple of things. A lot of it's based on relationship. You know? So a good example is this. Even me, if I use sloppy leash handling skills with a dog, it'll walk way better than an owner that's struggling. Why? Relationship. Owners are manipulative. They know they can't manipulate me. Big deal. I'm a fucking dog trainer. I've handled thousands and thousands of dogs. So the goal is for an owner is to get your dog to really fully understand the command that, yes, if your five-year-old grabs the leash, it'll listen. But that's a perfect world. We can only do the best we can do. Next.
Svenja, good evening, guys. Currently watching you guys in the car while my partner is driving on our road trip. Would not miss a What Would Jeff Do Live for anything.
Hey, hey, Svenja, I love you. Svenja's in Germany. Mm-hmm. Svenja's
she's newer to our world. Now she's consistent.
Wie geht's? Wow, it's late. It's holy shit. Svenja, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. What are you?
Road trip.
Oh, road trip?
Going on a little holiday.
Yeah, but they should freaking stop by now. Next.
Ryan. It's Ryan.
Hey, Ryan.
Hey, guys, just wanted to say thank you so much for everything the past week. The shadow program was an excellent experience. 3.5 more hours of driving left. Take care, and I will see you guys soon.
Ryan, I'm sorry that I missed you. I was buying duck heads. I didn't know what time you were coming in. Damn it. You missed the photo op and everything.
We'll see him in October.
We'll see you in October. That's true. Yeah, let me know. Give me your email address so I can send you a ticket to the Chicago seminar. And if things change for Canton, get down to Canton. Next.
Michelle, good evening. Jeff and Joelle. Love watching the dogs swimming on your Facebook today.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Did a Facebook Live.
Nice.
Yeah, did a Facebook Live. Thanks. They have a good time. We do that a couple times a day. Today was just twice. Next.
Yassine, do you like in-home training more or board and trains?
Well, we don't do in-home training. I like the results from a board and train. Personally? Okay, so.
I know the answer to this.
Okay, go ahead. What's the answer? So I can have my sip of my.
He loves in-home training.
Why?
He loves it.
Why?
Because you get to like work with the people one-on-one. Hands-on. Mm-hmm. Board and train is just like you're just getting the reps in and like doing it all in the center.
Yeah. I believe that I can get the most. So right now, you can't hire me for five sessions at your house. I'm just not available. It's not even a money thing. I'm literally not available for that. My time. You can hire me for one session at your house. And but that's not enough. That's the problem. But I can get a lot done. I can get a ton done in an hour or two. It's very pricey, but I can get it done. I love that. I love it, love it, love it, love it, love it. Because it makes such dramatic change in people's lives that it's incredible. So I just have to figure out how to scale that, which I'm working on now. So next. Up top chat, 1999. Ooh, I like that emoji, NRA. Ahem. My sister brings her dog every day when she goes to work. One of my two dogs is shy because he is aggressive towards her, usually over food. No issues with humans picking up, touching his food. Use Bonker to correct him. Okay, number one, hopefully your sister's throwing you a little bit of cash. Right? Right? You are saving her anywhere from $22 to $40 a day. So unless you treated her like shit growing up and you just owe her big time. Or you slept with her best friend and she's still pissed off about that. So that number three, yeah, I know. Hey, man, I've been there.
If he was smart, she wouldn't know about it.
If he was smart, yeah, but the best friend's got a big mouth. Right? So, so this is the thing. What I want you to do, number one, is with your food protocols, you know, you feed dogs, you know, once a day. So number one, for starters, feed them separate, crate them up, keep them separate, 5 minutes, food's gone, no free feeding, number one. Okay. That doesn't fix the problem, but that's a level of safety. Whenever I don't have hands on a dog and there's a level potential for a dog fight or a human fight, I've got to do triage. I've got to be like, at least let me make it safe. So you have that option, Ahem. Okay, you've got that option. Next step, what I would do is if you don't have access to electronics, you know, a proper shock collar, what I would do is this. Keep the dog on a leash, your sister's dog. Put food down for your other dog. Have a bonker. If you don't know what a bonker is a cotton towel. There's nothing in it. Like there's no metal pipe in it. Have the dog next to you. Step a little bit behind it. Feed your other dog. The dog that you've got, your sister's dog, is going to start going, hey, look at that. I want you to say really calmly, no. Remember, all punishment is calm. No. There's your marker. Wait a second. Hard as you can. It's a towel. You won't hurt the dog. On top of the dog's. Yeah, you hit the dog on the head. The dog will most likely hit the floor and go, holy shit, the world's coming to an end. And you'll be like, pretty much if you keep it up. And then all of a sudden your dog goes, oh, so that thought that was going through my head, like, that's bad. Yep, it sure is. Then the dog goes, well, ahem, what would you like me to do? That's a really good question. I'll tell you what. Let's go over there and lie down. That's what you do. Next.
Candy, thank you for all the content you put up. I started using the e-collar on my other dog and already eliminated some bad behavior.
I am so proud of you. This is the thing. I'm sure that I know there's more, but let me just comment on this. This is the thing. So many people are like, you should only use a shock collar if you've been properly trained on it. It's like, no. Like, don't give people these fucking iPhones till you're properly trained on them, because I don't know about anybody else, but I'm freaking struggling like you wouldn't believe. So what I want you to do is this. I'm proud of you. It's not that difficult. Next, keep going.
Candy part two. I was one of those owners that would come home and cry after walks, spent so much money on wrong trainers until I started watching you. Thanks for everything.
Thank you so much. Next.
Double DD pet lover. Oh, Jeff, come out wherever you are. This is at 8:04 because we still weren't on the show.
Oh, DD.
Calling us out.
Okay, here we go. You ready for this, DD? Okay. All right. You know what I was doing?
Oh, shit.
Okay. I was spending time with Angelo. Okay. My youngest child, my only son. Then I was finishing up feeding the dogs. And then I wanted to bring them up here so I can spend some quality time with them. And I came up and I did the show. And I'll make up the 4 minutes on the back end. We're going to go to 9:34 today. All right? But you, DD, no more questions from you. She's banned from the show.
You're done.
We're over with you, DD. We love you, DD. You can come back anytime.
Melissa says, hi, Jeff and Joelle.
Hey, how are you?
Lily. Hey, guys. Thoughts on prong collars that hide the prongs? I bought it from a trainer, but I'm thinking the price of being PC? What is that?
The prong collar? You mean like covers?
PC in public is the answer.
Politically correct.
Oh.
Okay.
I don't do acronyms.
It's not that you don't do acronyms. Is anybody surprised that Joelle doesn't know what politically correct is?
Ha ha. You want to do the show alone? I'll leave right now. Just kidding. I could never.
I was just going to say, you love this show more than I do.
Politically correct in public is the answer to my dog not responding to the prong with reactivity.
No, fuck it. Okay, show your shit. And look, okay, I've got clients in southern part of Australia, in Germany, in Sweden. Oh, I did a Skype in Sweden this week too. In Sweden. Okay, in Wales. When it's against the law, hide the shit. If it's not against the law, fuck them all. Okay?
No one saw your finger.
You know,
it's out of the screen. Fuck them all.
You just go ahead and come up to me and tell me you don't like what I'm doing with my dog, that my dog has a shock collar, prong collar on. Go ahead. Like, how rude do you want to get? Next. Hold on. Top chat. $4.99. Hey, Nicole. How are you, hon? I know you often say you don't recommend Malinois pet very often. Was I wondering if you would train a Mal differently than a GSD? If so, how? Yeah. Yeah. You know, it's not about training a Mal. Okay. Bottom line is this. Here's an interesting philosophy for everybody to think about. Just think about it. It's not a judgment. I'm not passing judgment on anybody. I'm not passing judgment. Everyone like this, I'm passing judgment on them. It's like, listen to my body of work, okay? Just listen to my body of work. I got 10,000 hours of audio out there. Listen to my body of work. You won't find me passing judgment, except for on PETA, bunch of fucking assholes. So other than that, I believe, listen, first of all, if you've got a Malinois you need help with, I will help you. But let's think about this concept. I believe that if you get a Malinois, you should not need a trainer for basic obedience. Think about it. If you're going to get a Malinois, which are incredibly high drive dogs that are not meant for family living and are mostly meant for sport and work. I believe that if you're going to get a Malinois, you should have the skill set to train basic obedience with the dog. And you should probably understand simple behavior modification. It's a challenging dog, not for me, but for, you know, for your average person. So what would I do differently? I would make sure that the dog was safe. So I wouldn't let, I mean, like most dogs, I don't let any dog slip up when it comes to aggression. I would want to make sure that dog was underneath incredible voice control. And I would want to make sure that dog understood tools really, really well, because the owner's going to have to probably rely on the tools at the beginning, or maybe even at the end, because of you're going to need tools to override some of its innate, you know, genetic qualities of its drive. So another top chat. Thanks for the top chats, guys. 1999. Hi guys, you've helped me so much. I'm so thankful. My dog gets scared and runs to hide when I use e-collar as reinforcement when she gets lazy during obedience training. Too high or not high enough. Normally submissive staffy. So Rachel, I don't know your skill set, hon. I don't know your skill set. So I doubt it's too low, right? But this is what I like you to do. Leash on the dog. Just because you're using an off-leash tool, but we use remote collars for on-leash obedience as well, state of mind stuff. It's possible what you've done is you've taken your, keep in mind, what was her name? I'm so sorry.
Rachel.
Rachel, keep in mind the remote collar doesn't give directional control. There's no directional control with a remote. Sit, down, place, heel. It all feels the same to the dog. It doesn't tell the dog what to do. So a lot of times what people are doing is they're using the remotes without teaching what the remote means when it comes to obedience. Stopping unwanted behaviors, the educational curve is like, there is none. Dog gets up on the counter, make it suck. Dog goes, counters are terrible to jump up on. That's an easy one. But for obedience, you want to do, we use it as a layering communication device over an existing command. Next.
Josue, hi guys.
Hey Josue.
Caitlin, how do I stop demand barking?
Jose wants to ask Caitlin a question?
No, Caitlin's asking you the question.
Oh, Jose just said hi.
Yeah, that's it.
Oh, then next, Caitlin. Oh, what was the question?
How do I stop demand barking?
Oh, be more accommodating to your dog and it won't do it, you know? tell your dog to shut up in a way that dogs understand shut up. How does a dog understand shut up? You make it uncomfortable to bark. Right? So remote collar, bark collar, which goes off automatically, bonker, no, bonk. So most people don't need barking dogs. Next. I'm not against a dog barking. I'm just saying, like, here's a great example. The last time we did socialization, there was about 20 dogs in the socialization yard. Maybe not the last time, but there was a time. And when I was doing a live out there, and someone said, how come they're not barking? Yeah. And I'm like, why would they be barking?
Right.
Like, what's there to bark? Like, what's there to bark at? Mm-hmm. That's like having, I was at the ballet, Swan Lake, and there was like, 5,000 people. How come it was quiet? How come people weren't yelling and screaming? Because it wasn't a freaking AC/DC concert. It's the ballet. You sit there, you shut up, and you watch. Yeah. When you're at a cocktail party, how come you can overhear someone's conversation from across the room? Because it's not a crowded rock bar. It's people are talking in normal voices.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Heather, hey there, beauties. E-collar helped me stop a client's dog from attacking their cat today. Now she won't even look at the cat. Best tool ever.
And that's how you get it done. Mm-hmm. Next.
Anna, my dog absolutely hates getting nail trims. He will freak out and bite me. How do I get him to enjoy his nail trim?
Well,
reward while touching his feet.
Oh, okay. Who's that, Anna? Anna, okay, let's be honest. Does it matter if the dog enjoys it? Or step one, you just don't want to get bit, right? Step one, how do I stop my dog from biting me when I cut its nails? That's step one. Muzzle. Start with that. We do a counter conditioning program protocol with clicker, food, and we use a Dremel. there are people out there that are way better at grooming stuff than me and our company. We do it with dogs all the time, but I would look up some videos on how to cut nails, and it's going to be with either clippers or Dremel. I just like to use a Dremel. It should be with a clicker and food protocol. If they don't use a clicker, it should be a marker and food. Or do it the old fashioned way. Just grab your dog, lay them down, put a little bit of your body weight on the dog, secure the head, grab a foot, click, click, click. You can do that too, which we have to do, excuse me, with some dogs where the nails are really, really long. It's like, I can't even work you. Your nails are too long. So there's no time for counter conditioning. We have to literally muzzle the dog, hold them, you know, we'll hold them. Two people will hold the dog, and you got to get their nails cut. But their quicks are really long when they're that long. By the way, guys, if you have not subscribed to the show, hit subscribe and then hit notifications. If you like the show, thumbs up. If you don't like the show, it gives you the opportunity to give me a thumbs down. Feel free. That's okay. It's all engagement. Doesn't bother me. Negativity doesn't bother me. Next.
Rebecca, the muzzles you get from Amazon, do you experience any tears on the skin of the dog's nose?
Well, it's not that they're from Amazon at all. It's that they're from Baskerville. So we use Baskerville muzzles. Tears on the nose, it's too tight. So what you can do is, if the rest of it fits really well, but the nose is smushed in, you can put those Baskerville muzzles in warm water, warm to hot water, and stretch out that plastic a little bit. So maybe stretch it out a little bit from the nose. Try that. Next.
Anna, hey, Jeff and Joelle, thank you so much for your content. Any tips on how to condition a dog to behave at the groomer? He jumps and they can't get him to calm down. They tried fetch after 4 hours.
What? Why would a fucking groomer play fetch with your dog?
Desire it out.
Fuck that. Find a new groomer. No, find a groomer that knows how to freaking handle an excited dog. And you leave the room. Let me play fetch. Your groomer's play. Who's playing fetch? The groomer?
I don't know.
Because the groomer's got 4 hours.
Why are you yelling at me?
4 hours. That's a lot of grooming they can be doing. Are you paying them to play fetch with your dog? If I was a groomer and I had to pay.
We need answers, Anna.
If I had to pay fetch with a dog, I would charge. I could have freaking groomed 10 dogs. If you want to pay $500 to freaking play fetch, I'm opening up a $500 fetch business. You got to find a groomer that's not a wimp, that knows how to freaking shut your dog down. Not shut down your dog. Not shut down dog. Shut the dog down. No. It's arousal. Bonker. No. Boom. Yep. Bonker. It's okay to do that. It'll have a negative association.
Every groomer has some version of a bonker.
Yeah, all groomers do. Groomers are good at that.
Another top chat.
Bunch of top chats. Hold on here. Please call me Seth. It's weird to hear the pen name. I have access to an e-collar. Would you still recommend a leash over an e-collar? What was the question?
His dog is afraid of his sister's dog because it resource
food. Oh, you know, that's a good question, Seth. Seth, I actually would. The first time, I absolutely would. The first time, put the e-collar shock collar on the dog. I still want you to bonk the first time. I'm telling you guys, when you deploy a bonker properly, your timing is spot on. It's not that hard to get timing. I've got a video on that. We got a bunch of tape of really good bonker deployments, right?
I got a bunch.
Make sure we're really focused on it this weekend in Reno.
Why?
I'm putting bonker videos out.
Are you?
I'm going to put them on my Patreon channel. You know, I'm going to put them on my Patreon channel because I got to be careful about YouTube. They might consider that something in a negative way in the dog fighting spectrum, like, you know, abuse.
Can people share from Patreon though?
They can, but if it organically, but that's their problem then. That's their problem. So, but I got to read Patreon's terms of service too. All right. So, but first time bonk, then move to a remote collar. MX, where the hell is MX?
I don't know.
Would you say giving the intro to prong leash pressure is a good way to start a dog, not a puppy in training, or what would the first thing to do? He's in Brazil. I think he's in Brazil. By the way, your wife is beautiful. Congratulations. He jumps out of airplanes. So this is what I want you to do. First thing, yes, Well, first thing is this. You can do threshold stuff in and out of a crate, introduce the dog to the concept of leash pressure, get the dog just to follow you around. Hey, let's go. Let's go for a little, not a structured walk. Let's go 20 meters this way. Yep, right turn, 20 meters that way. Yep, right turn, 20 meters that way. Let's do that. Next.
Lori, do you have a video on counter conditioning? Dogs scared of loud noises, garbage cans, nail drilling, etc. Thank you. Or can you speak about it?
I don't do it. What you do is this. There's a couple of different theories. Some people are saying keep the dog busy during those times doing obedience, so the dog can only think of one thing at a time. That there's value to that. And then there's also the thought process of have your dog. Well, you don't do that with nails, you know what I mean? But for like thunder and lightning and fireworks, or have your dog lie down and learn how to deal with it. So you can do a combination of both. You can try both. Have your dog do place. Don't break place if you're afraid. You're correcting your dog for breaking place. You're not correcting your dog for being afraid. So therefore, technically, you are doing something. You're teaching the dog place duration. Or do something active with the dog. The problem is, if the fear response is so high, it might not want to do anything at all. And then nail stuff, grooming stuff, look up a YouTube video on that. Next.
Danny, how have you got along with the dog that could not be left alone? Max.
Who, Max? Max is doing great. We I hate to use the word fixed. He slept for 8 hours on night four, 6 hours on night three.
He's not wearing like anything at night. He goes to bed.
Naked, yeah. He goes to bed like a regular dog. Yep. Actually, he goes to bed better than most regular dogs. He sleeps 8 hours through the night, no tools on, sleeps in a wire crate, not reinforced. And he's doing great. He's doing fantastic. Yep, he's doing wonderful. And he's got no affection.
Zero
affection from us. And his life has dramatically changed. Yeah, it's dramatic. Like, his life literally has dramatically changed.
Pretty cool.
Yep, 5 years of a living fucking hell changed.
Even all his crazy panting is kind of like...
It's getting a little bit better. Yeah. Yep, he has that stage three heart murmur thing. Next.
Lori, what if a dog doesn't care about food?
Well, they all care about food because they do eat. Stop feeding the dog normally, like out of a bowl, and use food for training. But if you have a dog with low food drive, that's how you increase the food drive. Just like you're going to eat through training. If you don't eat, that's on you. You're not withholding food. Like, there's the food, you know. If not, you have to use more pressure. What's pressure? Remote pressure, leash pressure. More, you know, you have to do more of a compulsion-based training program. Next.
Lily, hi Jeff, just ordered an e-collar. How do you recommend to train for leash reactivity towards other dogs on the e-collar? And how long until I do that? Smart dog that loves to work. Thank you.
Okay. Good night, Joel.
Good night, Angelo. Thanks for all your help the other day, buddy. I got some good videos.
Good night, Papa.
Did you see that duck head?
Yeah, Romy threw it down Clover's shirt and didn't.
No!
You're talking about the duckhead.
Yes.
Threw it down her shirt.
Raw duckhead. Hey. Go.
That's traumatizing.
It was terrible.
Gross.
It was terrible. Yes. So Romy took a duckhead, a raw duckhead, and walked up to Clover, and she was sitting in a chair and put it down her shirt.
Oh my God.
You would literally think she just saw a dead body.
Yeah. Gross.
It was loud in the Gellman household for about 15 minutes.
That would have been a real scruff in my household back in the day.
Yes. So what was the question? Did I not answer it?
I don't know. E-collar, how do you like train for leash reactivity?
There's a couple of things you can do. A couple of different theories. Right off the bat, make leash reactivity suck. Boom. Set the dog up to make a big mistake. No, make it suck. There you go. And then now teach the dog how to properly heal. You can do that.
You got two top chats.
Two top chats. Rachel. Hey, Rachel, how are you? Added info. My staffy already knows all the commands. She just gets lazy and I'm trying to get faster reactions to commands. Compulsion. This is the dog that doesn't have the food drive. Compulsion.
No, this is the one that is something with remote collar. Oh, is she's asking if she's underwhelming. Like,
okay. Even though it knows the commands, it might not know it on the remote collar. You still have to sort of like layer the training over it, if that's what it is. If it's the one about the food drive, use more remote collar pressure. If it's the one about the dog getting nervous and fleeing, keep a leash on the dog anyway. It's different. Your dog can know down, like, okay, Here's a great example. And
all these top chats coming in.
Your dog can know down with food, with leash pressure, hand signal, remote collar. You still got to do a little bit of tweaking to it. $50. Super Carito 19. Hey, how are you? Hey, guys, I've been working with my dog to get her to stop peeing in her crate, but she hasn't stopped. She doesn't pee in the house, just in the crate. Her water is restricted. She's on a schedule for food and training. I'm not sure how to correct her. Fuck. Mm. Oh, God. Okay. This is what we're going to do. You really should do a Skype is what you should do. So I can really, really spend $50 to get you 15-minute Skype. Damn it. Super keto. I'm going to give you a suggestion. If that doesn't work, we're going to do a quick Skype. All right. Jeff@solidcaninetraining.com. Jeff@solidcaninetraining.com. I'll do that one off the books. All right. So, what you're going to do is this. Make sure your crate is small. Is it a she or a he? Her. It's a she. Okay. Let's try this. Shrink the crate's height. Got it? Shrink the crate's height so the dog can't stand up. Guys, this is not forever. Oh my God, Jeff says put the dog into a casket. No. Dog can't. First of all, dogs are in crates, are supposed to lie down and go to sleep. So literally, first of all, check for UTI. I doubt it's a UTI because you've said some things here that she doesn't pee in the house. So shrink the crates down. So width and height, the dog can pretty much go in there and lie down, and that's it. All right? Kira, here. Come here, sweetheart. Place. Plots. Something's going on with her lately. Something's going a little bit off with all these dogs today. You anything? Are your dogs a little bit weird? What do you call it?
Wes wouldn't run for you.
Wes wouldn't play fetch today.
He ran for me after work.
Maybe he's picking up something weird from these guys. Maybe. It was a really weird day today. It was really weird out there. And I was calm and neutral. I was just like, is it me? And I'm like, no. Like, what's going on here, Wes? Nothing.
You ran like a maniac.
Yeah. And I even like had a ball in front of me and I kicked it like just like short distance. And he was just like.
That's bizarre.
I'm like, what?
I'm not chasing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It was really weird. I'll try again tomorrow morning. We missed a top chat, I think. Damn it. Okay. So what I want you to do is that. Second of all, massive amounts of duration when you're home in place and in the crate as well. All right. Get the dog used to doing long duration. It's most likely going on up here in the dog. So sorry, I missed a top chat because I won't shut up. Next.
Lori, what if a dog doesn't care about food?
Did we already do that one?
Lily, we did that. Crick says, hi guys. Saw your piece on Instagram. Suffering and struggling does not mean love.
Yeah.
I have friends who struggle with dog problems and just settle with what they have and don't seem interested in help.
That's fine. Just walk away. There's nothing you can do about it. Next.
Gracie's crafts. What do you suggest instead of the bonker? My dog bites the brush and he really needs to be brushed. Also, what e-collar on your site do you recommend for Labradoodle?
It's not the breed of the dog. The Mini Educator, the 300, is good for almost 95% of the dogs. You're going to use the longer contact points. But use the bonker. Use the bonker. If you're struggling with the concept of hitting your dog with a towel, okay. Respect. I get it. But it stops the problem. It stops the problem. Your dog's biting the brush. I have no other suggestions. No bonk. Guess what? Problem solved. You won't ruin the relationship with your dog. Your dog won't hate you. You won't hurt your dog. Every time you properly apply a punisher to a dog, the relationship actually gets better. All you've got to do is read the comments on, not the ones that are like, fuck you, Jeff, you're an asshole. Because obviously, like, those are people that aren't doing their work on personal growth, number one, but on number two, on a lot of stuff. But the people that are like, I was nervous and afraid to do it. I did it. Holy shit. My relationship is better than ever before. Next.
I scrolled and found that top chat. It's from Seth.
Hey, Seth.
He says, should I feed him after he watches my sister's dog eat then? Or what should his meal process look like?
Okay. This is the cool thing, Seth. You decide. You decide. You know why? There's no reason why you, for efficiency, can't feed them all together. The problem is if you bonk or shock while the dog is eating, dog's not going to eat for a little bit. So if you want to do it before or after, I don't believe in this bullshit about like the humans have to eat before the dogs and the dog should lie down and watch the human eat so they think they're the pack leader. Fuck that.
That's so weird.
It's like, no, no, No. There's a million other ways to establish rank, you know, in your pack other than like who eats first. So next.
For sure, dogs always eat before me.
Yeah.
Nina, I've done kennel up, down, break at least 200 times. He goes in just fine, down, double down, but still whines and pants. So I just leave him in till he stops or correct has e-collar and prompt.
I would correct it. I would work on it. Now, every once in a while, I think in 2018, we had two or three dogs that we freaking couldn't stop from whining. We just couldn't. I thought of a lot of dogs, though. Usually most dogs respond in day one, definitely after 3 weeks. But we've sent some dogs home that were just like,
You've got a few whiners right now.
Yeah. But now like, now
not
like some
like
of them.
That. Not like yeah. Super.
So anything you can do to stop the whining, do it. Next.
Gabriel, Jeff, my pit mix is getting aggressive with certain dogs. Hackles go up and everything. Any tips?
Yeah. It's pain in the fucking ass, isn't it? Okay. This is what I want you to do. Number one, keep him away from other dogs right now. All right. He doesn't need to socialize more. Let's get him to ignore dogs. Hackles up. That's what you correct. Correct it. Remote collar bonker. No bonk. No remote collar. The first sign of arousal, correct it. Okay. Nip it in the bud right there. And then get your dog to be around other dogs. Not meeting on a leash. Not meeting off leash right now. That's a whole other safety protocol. And there's an art to that. But getting your dog now to be around other dogs without reacting is the number one goal. Next.
Seth, I have two dogs. My sister brings her dog over every day of the week.
You did that one.
No, this is a different thing, though.
Oh.
He's saying his dogs were awful at walking, and he started using your techniques, and the difference is
nice. Oh, I thought it was the food thing. I didn't want you to repeat.
Well, he's helping you with walking, too.
Okay. What I was going to say is you were repeating a couple of the questions. I wanted to make sure you didn't repeat them to save you some time. So thank you so much, Seth. Proud of you.
Caitlin, I've been walking my energetic 3-year-old lab from his kennel to the door with his prong collar and a leash because he would run and trample my shih tzu if he's in the way carelessly. Whoa. But he still continues, whines and tries to run even with a leash. I've been doing it for 2 weeks now. Will he stop eventually or am I just doing something wrong?
You're doing the same thing over and over and over again. You're getting the same results. What do you think will happen? You get the same results. Bonk. Bonk the arousal. Come out of the crate. No bonk. Oh, you're slowing down? Let's go now. There you go. Next.
Madison. Hey, guys. Working with e-collar. And seriously, I have a new dog. Only real big issue left to tackle is occasional dog aggression. Best way to work on it.
Occasional.
Thanks so much. It's the only thing left.
That's it. That's it.
Cakewalk.
Yeah, no problem at all. Holy shit. I just got this new job in the in Dubai. $250,000 a year. Awesome. Only problem. I'm scared shitless to fly. And I gotta commute every week. Great job offer though. By the way, I'm trying to
answer the damn question.
I'm trying to do a seminar there.
In Dubai?
Yeah, I got a tech. I got an email into my connection over there.
Lots of those motion sickness things.
I know. So, what was the question? Oh, aggression.
Tackle dog aggression.
Okay, I need to know way more information. Like, is it predatory? Like, I mean, bottom line is you need to make the act of thinking about being aggressive suck. But it's a two-way street. I mean, what's happening? I mean, are dogs rushing your dog, jumping on top of your dog? Is your dog fighting on sight? Is your dog doing it when it's overly aroused and play turns into aggression? Is your dog, like, there's so many variables. Are off-leash dogs running up to your on-leash dog? I need to know way more information when it comes to aggression. Next.
Mario. Hello, guys. Have a great show. I have 15 minutes to listen while I make tacos for dinner. I'll finish on the replay.
All right. Sounds good.
By the way, I hope you don't add bananas to tacos like you do salad.
Of course I do.
It's disgusting.
Well, you don't?
Well, instead of mashing up avocado, he mashes up banana and puts it on his tacos. You didn't know.
Doesn't everybody? Huh. Yeah. Taco. Yeah. Bananas with tacos are good. Mm-hmm. Next.
Caitlin, I already read that. Kayla, what would you do if you had a dog that objects and mouths you when you give a correction on the prong? How can I stop that? Should I even be correcting it with scoring at that point?
With what? With scoring?
Correcting it with scoring at that point.
I don't know what scoring is. So this is the thing. Yeah, I would use the bonker. No, bonk. You can't put your mouth on me. It's a choice. Dogs putting their mouths on owners are choices. Choices, bad choices can be corrected. Good choices can be rewarded. It's very simple concepts. Very simple concepts. So absolutely correct that. $9.99 from Seth. Swear to God, this is my last question. My two dogs have always been poor at socialization. I like to take them to the dog park, but I'm nervous they will attack the dog. Use the e-collar. Okay.
Dog park.
Seth, let me make it really easy for you, buddy. Never take your dogs to a dog park. Ever. This is the thing, buddy. You're under the impression, most likely, that that's what you're supposed to do with your dogs. Like a lot of people are, right? A lot of people are like, yeah, you get a dog. I mean, this is how brainwashed everybody is. They literally go to a shelter, adopt a dog. From the shelter, they go right to the dog park to let their dog run in the dog park because they thought that's what you do. And every time they drove by a dog park and seen all the dogs running around, you're not seeing the dog fights, though. You're not seeing all the freaking giardia. Right? You're not seeing all the humans getting bit. You're just seeing them playing. And then you're thinking that's what you're supposed to do. You already got two dogs, and your sister brings her dog over. So you got three dogs. There you go. That's all your dogs need. That's literally all your dogs need. My dogs don't play with other dogs. They only play with each other. And it's usually just Girl and Kira. You know? Tex, Mac doesn't play with dogs. He's a loner. And Tex doesn't give a shit. Tex is Tex.
Give a shit about anything.
Yeah. So don't worry about it. Next.
Tex is Tex.
That's right.
Did you answer this one about? Oh, yeah. The mouthing. Okay. Double DD pet lover. Are there any?
I thought we cut her off.
Double DD. Just kidding. Are there any dogs that exhibit personality types you would not use an e-collar on?
No. E-collar. No. No. See, e-collar is not, okay, in my world, and it's not because I'm lazy or don't have skill. Anybody that thinks that people that use e-collars don't have any skill, it takes skill to use an e-collar. Wait, if you see me work an e-collar, especially with a dog in a crate to quiet it down, that's a skill set. People that are like hunt dog trainers, that's a skill set. Like there is skill in e-collars. Getting a dog to stop jumping on a counter, there ain't no skill, and there shouldn't be. Turn it all the way up, hit a button, whoop, dog comes flying off the counter. Fix that, you know? So digging holes in the yard, getting in the trash can, getting in the litter box, no skill required. Teaching a good recall, that takes skill. Down, skill, place, skill. Doing send-outs, skill. Doing downs in motion, skill. Now, there's skill involved. What was the question? Oh, so any dog? No. So we don't look at dog. We don't look at the e-collar as the last choice. I look at it as actually the best choice. And then people say, well, if the dog needs it. Well, what do you mean if the dog needs it? How about this? Depends what you're trying to train. It's not if the dog needs it. That's like saying, do you use a leash on every dog? Most dogs need to have a leash on at least at the beginning. So no, but remote collars are great for all dogs, especially when you know how to use them. Next.
Caitlin, I want to train my dogs in the backyard, but as soon as we're out there, he thinks it's playtime and he's very distracted. What else can I do? Or is there any way I can correct this?
Yeah. Yeah. Get him to focus on you. Tell him to stop the nonsense. Yep. You absolutely can do that. Go outside. And just a firm leash pop is enough, usually. A firm leash pop. Remember, you control. Who's controlling the situation? What's her name? Caitlin? Caitlin. Who's controlling the situation? Well, the dog's controlling the situation, Caitlin. You guys, you have almost 100% over your dog's control. Control. I mean, yeah. I was trying to think of it.
100% control.
Control over your dogs. I knew I said something backwards. Yeah. Stop letting our dogs make all these decisions. Hey, Squirt, cut it out. We're working here. Now you just, I humanized it there. Now you have to figure out a way to translate that into dog speak. And what does it do? A good leash pop goes, oh, you want me to cut that out? And you can call me Squirt. Next.
That's actually her dog's name. Svenja. From Germany, living in Florida at the moment.
Oh, you're living in Florida. Oh.
Still doesn't explain why she's awake. Oh, wait, yeah.
So yeah, because it's same.
I shouldn't be awake.
You know what? You know what? They never called Joelle in high school. Queen of the time zones.
I was a straight A student.
You didn't know your time zones.
I did then. I was good at cramming and memorizing everything for the test.
Florida's in the same fucking time zone as we are.
No shit.
It's 8:57.
I don't think I ever even got quizzed on time zones.
No, they should have. Australia. What is that?
I have no freaking clue.
Plus 14. Okay.
Okay.
From the East Coast.
I'm glad you know everything. Carla.
It's not everything. I'll be in Florida next week.
My 7-month puppy chases frogs and cane toads at night. He puts them in his mouth and carries them around unharmed.
Is that David?
He will drop it straight away. Once I get the command, I bonk him if I'm there, but it is hard in the dark to bonk him before it happens. He does it even on lead for toilet breaks at night. It's so quick. He's just catching toads.
It's okay. Kill them and turn them into freaking food.
Ew.
Put them on the grill.
God.
What do you mean, oh my God?
No. Yeah. Frogs are cute.
Frogs are frogs are a food source.
Disgusting.
It's a food source. Remote collar. Make it suck. Mm. Next.
Blessing. After I stopped my dog's aggression, which stems from insecurity, with overwhelming force, e-collar, what would be my next step?
So this is the thing. Once you stop it, now you have to start training your dog what you want it to do. But there's an art to that too. I mean, it's not just about blasting your dog for being aggressive. You really have to understand what's going on with your dog. You know, I'm simplifying it a little bit. And so with anybody that has that deals with aggression, I would encourage them to do a minimum of a Skype session. It's not because I want to get money from you. It's because there is a little bit of an art to it. But the concept, though, is you make the thought of it suck. Then what do you do is this. You teach your dog how to exist around other dogs, or if they're aggressive towards people, exist around people. That's what you're going to do. So what do you do? Train all your obedience, get your dog to understand, being around other dogs and don't let them load at dogs. If it's dog aggression, no staring at dogs. You might have to put the dog into a little bit of avoidance for now, but get the dog around all the environmentals, whether it's dogs or humans that it used to aggress against. Next.
Britain, I have a prong collar, so thank you. My mini Aussie heeler is still reactive to people passing by. I need an e-collar. Any suggestions besides the mini 300 one you suggest? Maybe less expensive?
No, I don't suggest anything less expensive than that, unless you can find one that's less expensive. So on Amazon. So Dogtra or the mini educator are the only two that I would recommend on the lower end of things. I'm not sure. Yeah, Sport Dog. Excuse me.
Made you yawn
because
I yawned.
I know. I don't like to train on sport dogs. I like sport dogs are good for correcting. Level one is sometimes too hot for dogs. I don't like the variables in between them. I can't really fine tune the training the way that I train with them. So those are the two that I like. So save up for it. So just, you know, no, pack your food, make your food for the next 30 days. Don't drink any alcohol or soda for 30 days. Don't have any, no Starbucks, or Dunkin' Donuts, no going out for coffee, stop smoking cigarettes and stop spending money and going out for 30 days. You'll have enough money saved. That's $45 a week for a proper shock collar. Next.
Dre. Oh, nice. I made it. My 15-week Doberman service dog in training is doing great from your free content.
Awesome.
My dog trainer, Brittany, is excited for your seminar in Reno this weekend.
Oh, awesome. Great. Cool. That'll be fun.
Donna, hi guys. Took my okay Dane to board and train, and between you and my trainer and making it suck, I now have a great Dane.
That is cool. Proud of you. Next.
Britain, P.S. Tried one that has great reviews, but the dog didn't react and needs longer prongs, I think. I even shaved her a bit.
So this is the thing, though. Reviews, guys, review sites, reviews are fake. Be careful about that. So reviews can be fake. It's not that hard to get reviews. Just like we don't do this, but I always know this. Whenever I go to a social media page, like I know who's buying followers, and I know who's buying comments, and I know who's buying likes. It's very obvious. and people are doing it for their ego, the problem is they're going to be they're being penalized heavily by Facebook and by Instagram and by YouTube. They're going to be penalized. So same with review product reviews. Those are bought and sold. You can get negative reviews on somebody's product, get positive reviews on somebody's on your own product. So, but some people also are like, well, the dog didn't feel it. It could be fit though. You could have had this bad fit. It could be the contact points. The thing is, a lot of times some folks will say, well, my dog didn't do anything. I'm like, well, what would you like it to do? You still got to train the dog. But if you're pushing buttons and the dog's not feeling anything, I also don't know what brand it is. There's a lot of shitty ones out there. We get solicited for them all the time. Next. Hold on. There's a top chat. Oh, yeah. 20 pounds. 20 euro. I'm sorry. 20 euros. Tokaj with a heart. Tokaj.
So nice.
Thank you. I didn't know you're in Europe though, Tokaj. Oh, Tokaj is in Germany. That's right. They're on the euro now. Back in my day, I was in a different currency. That's when everybody had different currency. Then they all switched to the euro.
Back when I was traveling Europe, back when I was backpacking through Europe.
Next.
Sammy. Hey, Jeff and Joel. Dumb blind question. I'm blind. How does a prong collar work to correct a dog?
So, Dumb blind question. Oh, okay. So if you're visually impaired, what you can start doing is this. The way a prong collar does, it looks like a barbaric tool. If you've never order one so you can feel it. And it's so what it is it's okay. What's the best way to describe it? Okay. I'm just trying to find how descriptive you want me to be of it. What it does is it goes around the dog's neck. And when it sits there, it doesn't do anything. And there's about 10 pointed U-shaped barbs. So a U-shaped barb that are angled, that are all connected together. Each prong. And what it does, you'd think it would impale the dog, but it doesn't impale the dog. And what it does is when you pop the leash, which compresses the collar, it gives a very full compression around all 360 degrees, probably about actually 320 degrees of the dog's neck. Now, a lot of people are like, oh, it hurts. Yes, there can be some discomfort. But believe it or not, I have no problem using high levels of discomfort to change a dog's behavior. I absolutely have not. Most dog trainers wouldn't speak so candidly about that, which is too bad. Because owners are struggling. But believe it or not, a prong collar is not my top choice to if I ever wanted to cause real discomfort to a dog. It's just not. It's not the most effective way. Why does a prong collar work? Prong collar works because I firmly believe that it's a great way to communicate with a dog and they just innately understand that concept of quick pressure on the neck and then release. Because when it's engaged and they pull on it, it doesn't stop them because it's not being used properly. Next. But go to a pet store and feel one. If it feels sharp, it's the wrong brand. But just go to a pet store and feel one and ask them to put it together and then feel it. Because obviously, you're the one that can't see. You know this better than I do. Obviously, all your other senses are multiplied. So you're going to get a good sense of what it looks like. I don't know if you can, if you were born blind or if you became blind and you can still see things, I envision 3D models in your mind or not, what things look like. But you'll be able to get a good sense of at least what it looks like. And then you can actually put it, if you want to put it around your arm, we don't do this to clients, and then you can understand the concept of that pressure. So try that out. Thank you for asking. Next.
Hey, it's Christy. Hey, Jeff and Joelle. I have a 5-year-old Dobie who is pretty well-trained thanks to your technique.
Oh, awesome.
However, I take him out before I leave the house and he still poops in the dang house.
Are you crating him? I mean, I'd crate the dog for starters. Next.
Gary. Oh, just kidding. Dre, a bonker works wonders.
A bonker is one of the best a bonker is absolutely the best way to de-arouse a dog that we have found. And getting a dog to eliminate arousal, not drive, not energy, but arousal is key to a lot of stuff. And it's a great punisher as well. Next.
Gary, my dog runs from the room when I vacuum the floor. How do I get him through this fear?
I mean, you don't got to move your dog when you're vacuuming. That's not the worst thing in the world. So this is what I can do. Teach down and teach place. Make it really good. Bring the vacuum in. Leave it off. Vacuum the floor with it off. Your dog will look like you're crazy. Turn it on. Start distance. Move your way in. Reinforce place. Don't worry about that the dog's afraid. You can't break place. We do this all the time. We have many videos of ourselves vacuuming floors around dogs. I assure you, these dogs did not come to us like that. Next.
Josue, is this a different Josue? Do we have two?
There's a bunch, yeah, because somebody asked a question, and I'm like, Josue, you know the answer to that. You've been on this before. And he's like, it wasn't me. The next week, he came out.
Oh,
like,
it was the dog park
he's
one.
He's like, that wasn't me.
Huh.
Yeah.
Okay, so different Josue. My 10-month-old GSD training obedience is good when I'm giving him treats, but when there's no treats, he locks me out. When will that change, or will it? Love y'all.
No, it won't change until you apply a punisher for noncompliance of a known command. That's the magic of it all. So if your dog is doing well, if your dog is obedience literate with food, which is how we train all dogs how to do stuff, and then what you can do is you can start taking away food. So you do variable rewards. You can start doing variable rewards if you want to, which means not every time. All right. But if your dog refuses to do a command because there's nothing in it for them, sorry, like we've done this 500 times. I'm not gonna pay you every single time you sit down, place, recall. Like, no, it doesn't work that way anymore. You know this stuff. Now you apply your punisher. Then the concept is the dog goes, oh, I should do this or else a punisher is applied. They don't think that way. Logically, they're like, or it'll suck. But then you get people from the other side of the equation that'll go, so the reason why the dog is doing it is because it's afraid of getting punished. Okay, I can live with that. Next.
Liz, my Malmix doing so awesome thanks to free content, even ignored grazing rabbits at a park.
Wow.
With a pre-bonk starting out with moderate loading, our timing's getting better.
Nice. That pre-bonk is good. Pre-bonk, the pre-walk punisher, that's really, really good. And one thing to just take a step back, we obviously want to get to the point where we want dogs to do things because they want to do them. Because they want to do them. We absolutely do. But many dogs are selfish. Many dogs are selfish. We have to remember that. This concept of their man's best friend and they want to make us happy is bullshit. They like what they get when they make us happy. Absolutely. But does the dog go, I want to make my owner happy today? Or does the dog go, I want lots of free shit today? And does the dog go, I don't want bad stuff to happen to me today. I think it's more of that. I think a dog goes through life saying, I want good shit. I don't want bad shit. So what do? They do the right thing and they don't do the wrong thing. That's a pretty good motivator. It's a pretty good motivator. So, you know, you can craft it any way you want to, and you can think that your dog's doing things because it makes you happy. And yes, there is absolutely a relationship training. Like people ask me all the time, like, so with my dogs, I can call what I do with my dogs relationship-based training at this point with my dogs. That's why my dogs are so in tune with me. But that's because we're able to build a good relationship through the work that we've already done. But with a client's dog, if that's hard to do. And most clients can't do that because they have a toxic relationship. So they have to rely more on food and tools, as they should, in order to get that relationship they're looking for. Next.
Double DD. Anything for Angelo. He's a cutie. Next.
I was just thinking, what'd you do for Angelo?
I don't know.
Did she send us some cash or what? I'm supposed to buy him a gift? I was wondering, am I supposed to be buying him a
dreaming really
am I supposed to be buying him, am I supposed to be buying him a snack with some Top Chat money? Did I miss something?
No idea.
All right, next.
Sammy, meaning all the positive people say the prongs dig into dog's neck. I know now that the prong collar pinches, but does that happen by the prongs closing together when you give a correction?
So, no. Well, this is the thing. Technically it does dig into the neck. So does a flat buckle collar. Yeah, it's like a split thing. You know what I mean? A flat buckle collar digs into the neck. A martingale digs into the neck. A harness digs into the whole body. Yeah. I've just never, and I'm sure there are prong collar injuries. There must be. I've never seen one. I've trained over 7,000 dogs. I've given some very harsh corrections with them. I've never seen it before in my life. I've seen dogs get abrasions from skin allergies, but also I've seen that with nylon collars that are wet, especially. But in to say it's a pinch, when I think of pinch, I'm thinking of pinching, like, you know, a lobster claw, or pinching like a human you'd pinch. And it does. I don't it's think if, it doesn't feel like that either. It's not a pinching feeling. It's a compression feeling.
Yeah.
It really is a compression feeling. And it's a quick pop, because people that use choke chains, it's the same concept. People that use slip leads, it's the same concept. A martingale collar popped. A martingale collar, if you look up the patent of a martingale collar, a martingale collar is a patented device. And if you look up the original patents, they call it a limited choke. A martingale, this might be a newsflash to some people that are pros of martingales but don't like any other tool. The martingale collar is designed, the design of it, the true nature of it by the people that designed and manufactured it was to give the dog a choking sensation in order to get the results that they wanted. And then for the folks out there that are using head harnesses like Gentle Leader or Halty, news release, the Gentle Leader, don't be misled by the name. I'm not against them, guys, at all. That is a punishment device. It has one purpose. A Gentle Leader has one purpose and one purpose only, and that is for punishment. Absolutely. That is exactly what it's for. So there's folks out there that are like, I will only use positive training. I would never use a prong collar. I use food and a Gentle Leader. I'm like, no, you're wrong. You're misguided. You're actually using punishment to train your dog. Just because the item has the word gentle and you're ignorant and you don't understand actually stuff, you're wrong. You're absolutely using punishment. Actually, a Gentle Leader can be a harsher punisher than a prong collar. I've seen it. When I was over in Australia, they used Gentle Leaders. I was like, holy shit, that's firm. I actually might have said firm as fuck. I was like, whoa, holy shit. I was surprised. I've seen some hard corrections in my life, but I was like, whoa, holy shit. I never saw him use that firmly before. Next.
Firm as fuck.
Next.
Tammy Rizzo says, happy belated birthday, Joelle. Hope you had a well-deserved day off. Thanks, Tammy and Rizzo. It was great. I think I still edited videos and stuff, though. I can't ever take a full day.
What'd you do on your birthday? You're 25. Tell us about your birthday.
Do anything. I went to dinner Sunday night.
Nice. With
my family.
Your sisters and brothers, yep. And your mom. Mm-hmm. And you, and that was on Instagram.
Yep.
You had salmon.
Yep.
Rice.
Didn't eat the cake.
You did, was it right? No, it was risotto.
Yeah, I didn't eat that, though.
You didn't eat
it? I gave it to Brendan. I had Brussels sprouts.
Ooh, how were the Brussels sprouts cooked?
Not that good.
What, did they boil them?
They weren't crispy.
They boiled them, right?
Yeah.
Steamed them?
They weren't that
what
great.
The fuck? Can't you guys cut them in half and put them in the grill?
Right.
That's all I want. That's all I want you to do. Or at least put them in a saute pan.
Like something. Crunch them up a little
bit. Anything.
Yeah.
Anything. Yeah. Oh, because you had dinner. No cheesecake.
No cake.
That's good. Got a wonderful gift.
Yeah.
Blanket. That's all that.
I got a bunch of Starbucks gift cards.
Oh, that's good.
They all know I drink a lot of coffee.
You're set for life. Okay. And then on your Monday with your birthday, did you go to the gym?
I think so.
Went to the gym. Did I see you Monday morning?
I think.
Okay.
I think we went
to the gym. Yeah, you did. I did.
Went to the gym.
Nice. Did something with the dogs, probably.
Took my dogs probably on a walk.
Yep.
So bad, I can't even remember.
It's okay.
Prepped dog food.
Nice.
Went food shopping.
Nice.
Edited some videos.
Did your hair? Did you do any hair? No, hair wasn't done. Mm-mm. Got a massage yesterday. Mm-hmm. That was nice. Good for you.
Yeah.
Good.
It's good.
Relaxing day. Mm-hmm. Definitely you looked rested.
Yeah.
Good. Much needed. Got your car washed.
Oh, yes. Did that.
Got your car washed. Yep. That's the highlight of the day. Seriously.
It is.
It is. I know.
I hate a dirty car.
I know you do. All right. Next.
Holly, I support the use of tools such as prong collars. They've changed the game for myself and my relationship with my dogs.
Nice.
Jeff, thank you for being you and strongly advocating for your beliefs.
Mm. That's what you get. I know. You're welcome. Proud of you. I'm proud of all you guys. I'm the guy with the big mouth. I'm just proud of everybody. You know? Next.
Geo the racer. My dog gets nervous with loud cars, buses, big trucks, etc.
That's a fucking pain in the ass.
He's good walking on the boulevard. Tried him on Thayer and he was so scared and shaking.
I'm afraid on Thayer Street these days.
Yeah.
What did you mention? He wants to go to the pack walk? Mm-hmm. Come to the pack walk. Who's that?
Geo the racer.
Geo, make sure you come to the pack walk. Make sure you buy your ticket. You'll do fine. We'll help you out. Thayer Street can be tricky. The Boulevard is good, but Thayer Street can be tricky because Thayer Street's a little bit, if anybody doesn't know, it's in Providence, Rhode Island, up by Brown University. Thayer Street can be a little bit tricky. A lot of environmentals there. If the motorcycles are there, that's a whole other thing. Mm. But go on the pack walk. You'll enjoy it. Make sure you pick up buy a ticket. They're free, but you still got to get a ticket to it. So just so we know who's going to be there. Next.
Shalanda. Hey, J times two. Just looking. Took in an 8-week-old husky yesterday. Found out she was taken from her litter at 4 weeks.
Oh, old. Man.
Very rambunctious. Plays very rough. Would love any suggestions you may have.
Someone's got to set that dog straight. Mm-hmm. Will your other dog do it? Will your other dog set it straight? If not, you got to do it. But, I mean, rough play is rough play. It's not the worst thing at all. But I'd put an off switch on that dog. Believe it or not, 8-week-old pup, you can do it. Massive amounts of structure. Excuse me. Massive amounts of structure. Next.
Ashley, trying to get a dog to stay calmly in the crate. He's currently gated in kitchen, but is now chewing furniture, panting, escaping. Totally unsafe. What would I do to reduce anxiety, shaking, fear of crate?
Put him in there. Put him in there. Get him to lie down. That's what you do. Got it? 8 hours tonight. Put him in. If he came to our training center, he'd go into a crate. Next.
Oh, I just bumped my spot. I'm so sorry, guys. Hold on.
Go to jeffgellmanseminars.com, jeffgellmanseminars.com. You can see the tour schedule. We're going to be in Reno this weekend, and then Canton, Ohio, and then Collinwood, Ontario, Canada. We just announced Atlanta for 2020. We've got so far, we're going to be doing Knoxville, Tennessee in 2020 as well. We're adding a new city in 2020, Knoxville, Tennessee, and then we're doing some international stuff, the UK, Australia. We're doing this year, 2019, we're doing Hawaii, we're doing Alaska.
It's only letting me go back to 837 now. So I can't even see the old
thing. Where are you, hon?
I'm at Canadian, but I feel like there were definitely way more before that. Who's the last one we just read?
Geo the Racer. Hi, Jeff and Joelle. Fairly new to the channel. I have a 1-year-old female nervous mutt finding it hard to do basic obedience. She's always thinks she's in trouble. Any advice? Thanks. Okay. So she's really, really nervous. If she thinks she's in trouble, get your energy in check. I'm not blaming you. Just, I want you to just hear me out here. So it's possible that you're frustrated. All right. The dog's picking up signs from you. So there's an art to it to stay calm, stay relaxed. Don't take it personal. Leash on the dog, prong collar on the dog, food, clicker, start with the basics. Sit, place, let's go for a walk, do some engagement games, do things like that. All right? Jenna, do you ever go to California or Florida? Why is that the last question too?
I know, seeing that we're up.
Oh, wait, hold on. Oh, no, Geo the Racer. Oh, that's an old question. I see. Hold on 1 second.
We're like way up there.
Okay, got it. Oh, I'm sorry, guys.
Keep going. More.
Joelle, man, we can't have dead space like this.
I know, I'm so sorry. You two just bumped me.
God, come on. Help me out, Joelle.
Right there, Shalonda. So okay. 8-week-old puppies, and okay, now we're at Ashley.
Yeah, okay. We already did that one.
Okay. Britain. Yep. Sorry, mini Aussie healer is reactive at home, still not walks. Way better on walks because of you.
A reactive at the home? Bonk. No, bonk. Next.
Megan, ever had a dog that you felt couldn't be remote collar trained off leash? Got a dog who does well on the remote collar recalls, but if she gets spooked, she runs to safety. She's gotten better with.
Yes, I've gotten that before. Keep a leash on. A dog like that maybe will never be off leash. We're not going to be thinking negatively here, but be careful because it's a flight risk. The dog can get killed by a car. But yes, we've gotten dogs that are very, very fearful. Their fear drive overtakes everything. There's an art to how to do that. You pretty much have to make it suck to run away from you. And that sounds counterintuitive, but it's better than a dead dog. Next.
Megan. Oh, right there. He's gotten better with long line drills, but still ever had a dog like
yes,
this.
I have. Next.
Gabriel, I love your dog art in the background. Where did you get them?
Aaron took your dog on Instagram. Next.
Rebecca, Baskerville is on Amazon and it had semi-bad reviews.
I don't care about those bad reviews. I'm telling you, as somebody that uses muzzles all the time, they're great. They're great. That's so use them. Okay, keep in mind how many people don't like muzzles. Just the concept of muzzling a dog. You can pay attention to bad reviews. I'm telling you, Baskervilles are fantastic. And this is from the guy that uses muzzles a lot on all my biting dogs at seminars have to be muzzled. They have to be. Next.
I'm gonna scroll.
Who's this person?
Canadian. Hey guys. Oh good, that's where I'm at. Okay, so I'm not that far behind. Good. Canadian, hey guys. Client has leash reactive dog towards dog. She lives in an apartment, started structured walks, but every time the elevator door opens, he goes nuts at other dogs. Tried correcting, but didn't stop the behavior. Should I go higher? I told them to take the stairs, but they refuse as they live on the top floor. I only suggested stairs to start until the dog knew a proper heel.
So there's an art to this. You have to role play it. Get a friend's dog. You got to get a friend. That's asking a lot of the dog, number one. So you got to get a friend's dog to be in the elevator. You have to role play it. I would bonk the dog extremely firmly, and then I would have the dog go in, come out, go in, come out, go in, come out. What I would do is I would first try it on an empty elevator, believe it or not. It sounds like it doesn't make sense, but the opening of the door that could be the trigger, go in and out, in and out, in and out, and then open up the door, sees a dog, bonk. Next.
BP, I hear you were opinionated on vaccines. My instincts agree, but how do you protect a dog from parvo, etc.? Are there good vax and bad vax?
I would want my dog vaccinated against parvo. There are certain vaccinations. You have to do rabies. You have to do rabies. I just don't think you have to do rabies every year. But of course you'd want your dog vaccinated against parvo. I'm not saying no vaccines. I'm saying we over-vaccinate. And this is just this is literally an opinion. A lot of my content is based on fact because I've proven it over and over and over again that it works. Almost every time. So when I make a recommendation on dog training, it works almost every time. So it's not an opinion. But vaccinations, I have no knowledge base enough other than from the studies that I've read, which can be skewed in any way that I guess I want to look at it. But I know what's inside vaccinations, human vaccinations and dog vaccinations. I also know how powerful the drug companies are. And I know it's in the best interest the perfect example of, so get your dog vaccinated against parvo. Here's a great example. The state of Rhode Island, up until a couple of years ago, you had to get a rabies shot every single year. Every year, you had to get a rabies shot. Every single year.
Jeez.
All of a sudden, they passed a law saying you don't have to get it until every 3 years. Did the vaccination change? No. It's the same. Ready? I go to the vet. It's been 3 years and one day. The vet says he thinks it's 3 years, or she thinks it's 3 years if it's a female vet. I go in for the shot. They check the records. They go, Mr. Gellman, you're a day over. If you're a day over 3 years, the vaccination is only good for a year. I'm like, fuck. I'm like, are you going to put the same, use the same syringe? They're like, oh yeah, it's the same medication. It's the same medication going into my dogs. Now that medication is only good for 1 year though, instead of 3 years. So is that in the best interest of the dog? Who made that law? Who had that law passed? Let's follow the money trail. Is that medical or financial incentive? So that's where, like, is it in the best interest of the dog? A lot of vets are starting to speak out against it too. Next.
Tyler, not a question, but can you give my boy Beau a shout out? He just had a lumpectomy and got a 2 week recovery.
Beau, I'm glad you're still around. Don't die. Next.
Jake, Jeff, Joel, thanks for addressing earlier the part about ignoring people who berate us because of our levels of stimulation in public.
Yeah.
That's a hurdle I've struggled with because of public perception.
Of course. Who gives a flying fuck? Next.
Nicole, have a
if everyone, for all the people that think they can tell other people how to train your dogs, here we go. Here's my public service announcement. Go down to an animal shelter. Adopt a dog. Train it any way you want to. I'll leave you alone. Next.
Nicole, have a surprise half Mel, and I'm very nervous now, even though your videos have worked great for her.
Hold on 1 second. She's nervous?
Yeah, because you went on a rant about how people shouldn't have Mel's, and she has a surprise half Mel.
But what do you mean surprise half Mel?
She probably didn't know it was half Mel.
Then what does it make a difference?
Now she knows.
Now you know. That shouldn't change anything.
And your videos have worked great for her.
That shouldn't change anything. That's sort of like this. I'm happily married for 18 years. My wife's madly in love with me. This is a story, obviously. My man's madly in love with me. I'm everything for her. The best guy she's ever met. It's our 19th wedding anniversary. She finds out I'm Jewish. She's like, "You are? Oh, I don't like Jewish people." Like, what? What, that new information all of a sudden changed 18 years of freaking you madly in love with me? No. What does it matter? Next.
Surprise, I'm half Mal.
Yeah.
OP. Pardon me if I was wrong about your take on vaccines. You don't have to apologize.
Okay. That's okay. That's fine. This is the thing about vaccines. I think can we ever get the facts on vaccines? Can we ever get the actual facts on vaccines? So I can say bonking works. Why? Because it does. I can show proof after proof after proof after proof that bonking works. So that's one thing. But vaccines, are we ever going to get the truth on vaccines? Will we ever get the truth on it? I mean, do we all know that we're putting lead and mercury and baby fetus skin in our bodies? I mean, are we ever gonna get the fact on that? Are we gonna get the truth on that stuff?
Are we gonna go on like every conspiracy theory here?
It's not a conspiracy. Take a vacuum vaccination, reverse engineer it, you'll know exactly what's inside of it. Next. Right.
Canadian says, by the way, I fucking love you guys.
I love you too.
I don't know why. We love you too though.
I can't believe people don't drop off like flies. Why does the show keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger? You know, it's like our analytics are like really getting impressive, at least for this show, like for me. Yeah. I mean, that's what I mean. It's like for some show, like Joe Rogan, we have nothing to compare with Joe Rogan or Ben Shapiro or, you know, people like that. But
dog training
for this 3 times a week. Our numbers are doing pretty well. I'm happy. So
Pichu, not the Pichu, just Pichu.
Right.
Hi, Jeff and Joelle. It's been a while. What is usually the start point on a separation anxiety case?
Starting point, shutting the dog up. Kennel him up, teach him how to shut up, or the dog how to shut up in the crate. That's step number one. Mm-hmm. Next, step number one. You know what? If you want to struggle, you struggle. But boy, I don't want to hear any audibles out of you. Next.
Rye bread. I love rye bread. What would you recommend if you can't find a dog sitter? Are boarding places okay?
If I told you yes and you boarded your dog and it sucked, I mean, boarding places are like, you know, like restaurants, I imagine, right? I don't know if that's the best example. I mean, so some are, some aren't. Do your due diligence. Try to build a relationship with a place. Find a daycare that you like. I would find a daycare that you like and find one that also offers boarding and see if you can start, you know, getting your dog in there. Next.
Walk in Truth Ministries. Bonking my dog has changed everything. Thank you, guys.
You're welcome. Ain't that the truth?
ADM. Looking for advice. My dog is fearful of strangers. He reacts by backing away or sometimes barking. Mm. He will still take food. I hope to get him comfortable with stranger
petting. Nope. Okay. I want you to stop that. Please stop letting strangers feed your dog. Nope. Don't do it. Just don't do it. Get your dog to exist around people, not interacting. I'm not a big fan of that protocol. I'm not a big fan of that protocol. I'd sort of demonstrate something like that in my seminars. The goal, though, isn't for strangers to be feeding your dog. There's too many variables involved. It's too high of a bite risk. I would get your dog to start walk. I don't want your dog doesn't have to like strangers. Your dog just has to exist around them. So the theory is, dog, mind your own business. Nobody matters to you. Let's have that philosophy. Next.
Anna, you guys are hilarious. Yes, the groomer played fetch with my 7-month-old doodle because he wouldn't calm down.
Yeah.
4 hours later, they only clipped his torso and legs and called me to get him and charged me for half.
Man, that groomer's got way too much time on their hands. I'm sorry.
Oh, here we go.
Okay, no. Okay. If I'm going to piss off the fucking groomers, out there, okay. But I bet you I won't. Okay, let's do a poll. Whoever knows a bunch of groomers, show this video to your groomer. Ask your groomer this. Would you, if you had a dog that was out of control, I mean, do people think that, oh, that's a groomer that really loves the dog or loves the client or will go any distance for the client? Fuck that. No. Uh-uh. Doesn't work that way. Ask your groomer this. Would you ever play fetch with a dog for 4 hours?
I can do that with my own personal dog.
To get it to calm down? I wouldn't be surprised if the high 90% would go, first of all, after they pick their mouth up off the floor and they try to mumble the words, fuck no. Or do people think, oh, you'll do anything for your client. That's great client customer service. That's not great customer service. It's just not. No. You're not serving yourself, a business owner, or serving the client in the best way by doing that. You can't calm the dog down. Hey, give me your dog. This is what I'm going to do to your dog. You go out, you leave the business, not because I don't want to show you what I'm going to do. I'll do it in front of you, but it's more effective if the owner's out of the picture. Grab the leash of the dog. The dog's out of control. No. Boom. Bonk. Guess what? Dog goes, oh, you can cut these right now, honey. Just like that. Guaranteed. Give me that dog. I'll have that dog pause up on the fucking counter and picking out colors. Next.
Rye bread. Could you do a quick example of bonking, please and thank you?
Okay, I do. It's on my, I've got videos of it. Go to my YouTube channel, which you're on right now. Look up bonking. Next. I can't because I'm not going to bonk one of my own dogs for doing, they don't need to be bonked. And I'm not going to bonk Joelle because I'm scared of her. Next.
Melanie, holy shit, I caught you live.
Yeah, you caught us live and we're about to go off the air in 2 minutes. Next.
Bogdana, good evening. How are you guys doing? Thank you for all your content.
Hey, Bogdana. I think we got a Skype. It might be tomorrow. Next.
Kim.
Oh, shit. We got to catch a plane tomorrow.
Yeah, I know. I'm not even packed or anything.
I got to do food
prep. But I did get a Rolly.
Did you?
So I keep up with Jeff in the airport now. Yeah, I get a rolly. I'm an adult. I'm 25. It's time.
Okay. Next.
When introducing a new puppy to a resident adult dog, what behavior is acceptable, unacceptable between them? Do they have to share toys, beds?
There's a lot of variables here. When you say puppy, you're talking 8 to 12 week old puppy. I have no idea what the skill set of your existing dog is, how it does with puppies. Bottom line, you don't want bad stuff to happen to that puppy. So they don't have to share anything. That puppy should be spending 20 hours a day in a crate. I've got very strict protocols on puppy, introducing a puppy to your house. Right now, 20 hours a day in the crate, minimal time out with the other dog, but I don't know your other dog's behavior at all because it can go totally wrong. Next. This is the last question.
Tokaj. Hello, J&J. In between, I work on off-leash heel with Caucasian on e-collar 800. In between with distractions, we walked by a cat that was sitting in the middle of our way and he ignored it.
Awesome.
He also beat separation anxiety following your protocol 100%.
Awesome.
And this is a breakthrough for us because I can go to work again and this means we will survive.
Tokaj, cash flow is good.
Nice.
Good. Okay, everybody. We got to end the show. What's today? Wednesday? We'll be back on Saturday night. Ooh, but hold on here.
Saturday Night Live.
But that's Reno. Mm-hmm. Reno is Pacific or Central?
Central?
I think it's Central time, right? Mountain time. Is that Mountain time? No, it's not Mountain time. That's Arizona. Anyway, Saturday morning, find out what time the show. It's not going to be at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. It probably will be closer to 9 or 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. All right. We'll put an announcement out on, it'll be on YouTube. There'll be a thumbnail on YouTube and there'll be a thumbnail on Facebook. And then something goes up on Instagram as well, announcing Saturday night show. Madly in love with all of you guys. Big weekend in Reno. You can still go to jeffgellmanseminars.com. Audit tickets we usually always have. Thank you guys for everything you've been doing. If you want to do a Skype, if you need more detailed information, you can go to my website, solidcaninetraining.com, and you can actually get a Skype from the actual shopping cart. That's how many of them we do. Once you pay for that, Jessica will schedule it. But you know, but you can just keep doing all this free stuff. I've got 3 shows a week that are free. Instagram stories, IG stories on Mondays. We do an AMA on that. Okay. And then my Patreon channel. The Patreon channel, you can jump onto the Patreon channel and then you can also ask a question there, which you get an answer. All right. Madly in love with you. Thank you all for all your great questions. Thank you all for all your hard work. Really, really appreciate all of you. I feel blessed and honored. So thank you so much. Bye-bye.